Quer o check, 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 check. Okay, guys, we are going to start our service in 10 seconds. So if you can all come into the sanctuary and prepare yourself.
Udah mulai.
Okay, good morning, church. It's so good to see you who are here, and also at home. It's so good to be worshiping at the same time with you. I want to invite all of you to stand up. We are going to sing "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing."
From home, perhaps from other place, and we welcome each and every one of you. And if you're new with us for the first time, we'd love to be able to talk with you or to communicate with you. So if you would just go to the website of the church, there's a form you can fill out, and we will get back to you. And so we cherish this time and this opportunity. We have some announcements we want to share with you. First of all, we want to congratulate Bruce and Doris Tondra and their son Matthew, who's now an uncle. His sister gave birth to baby Charlotte Costa and this week, and so everybody's doing fine as far as we know. I have to say this because my wife always asks me, the baby's 6 pounds, 13 ounces, and 19 and a half inches. So it's a good-sized baby. So we're thankful for that. Now, the next thing we want to announce is to make sure that all of you have made a commitment to vote this year. And so early voting has started on the 13th and go through to the 30th. And then, of course, the big day will be the November 3rd date. So please, if you're able to vote, we want to encourage everyone to do so. Now, we also want to go over a few things about the official reopening of the church. And that will happen next Sunday, okay, the first Sunday in November, November the 1st. Now, we have to follow a lot of different restrictions and protocols for the welfare and safety of everybody concerned. And so there are too many for us to go over in detail during this announcement time. So what we encourage you to do is go to the website or to one of the platforms that the church has, like Facebook and Twitter, so on and so forth, and you will see those protocols there. And so please follow those as much as you can. Now, also on Sunday, November 1st, there is a lot of things happening. For example, not only the official reopening of the church, but on Saturday night, you got to turn your clock back, all right? Or you're going to be here late. And so we want you to be sure, turn your clock back so that you can arrive here on time. This is for daylight savings time. And then there is going to be an online ministry team meeting. This will happen from 1 o'clock to 2 o'clock online. And there are instructions have already gone out to everybody. But just in case you missed it, we are going to be meeting in the Wednesday prayer meeting room. That's on our website. And it'll be from 1 to 2 p.m. So please sign in for that. And then mark it down on your calendar. On November 15th, we'll have our annual business meeting. And this is when we do the important business of the church, such as presenting the new 2021 budget and some other things that are going to be going on. I do this once a month, and so this is the time of the month to do this. We have tithes and offerings, okay, that have faithfully been given, and we thank you so much for those who continue their support even during these difficult times. But if you go to the website, again, there are multiple ways that you can give your tithes and your offerings and your support. So go to the website, and you will find all those different ways to continue supporting this ministry. Let's bow our heads in prayer at this time and ask God to help us as we go along. Father, we thank you again for your goodness and your kindness. We thank you for your protection. And Father, we thank you for watching over us so, so well. We thank you, Father, for this telecast that's able to go out week after week. And Father, we thank you for the wonderful team of volunteers who work really hard to make sure everything goes as smoothly as possible. And Lord, as we come together, we want to pray for our nation as it enters into a season of elections for national leaders. And Father, we know that a lot is at stake. And so, Lord, we pray that you will guide and give people wisdom and courage to vote as you lead. And we pray, Father, that we will come away with a set of good leaders who will look out well over the affairs of the country and also the welfare of the people. Lord, we don't want to take anything for granted, and for sure we don't want to take for granted the reopening of the church next Sunday. And for some of us, Lord, we've just been looking forward to this day so much. Father, where we can see one another again, person to person, that Father, we can communicate with our eyes and our body language and with our words, Father, how much we care for one another. And so, Lord, I pray that this meeting, this reopening will happen. We understand, Lord, in Dallas County that there's been a spike in the number of cases and hospitalizations, and we're not sure exactly what the government officials will do. And so, Lord, we pray, though, that it'll be safe to open and that, Father, we will be able to come together. And so, Lord, we thank you for that. And Father, we want to just continue to thank you for each and every person who tunes in, or each and every person who is here under the ministry of your word, and also in the ministry of worship that happens here. Lord, we pray that this will be a blessed time, that something that it will quench a thirst that's in each of us, Lord, to be close to you, to hear from you, to commune with you. And Lord, we pray that you will do all of these things through the ministry of your Holy Spirit. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Church, let us stand up and let us sing for the reason why we are here and for the only reason why we can be here. This is Amazing Grace. Okay, you may clap your hands. If you are at home, you're welcome to clap your hands too.
This is unfailing love that you would.
First John 4, verse 13 until 16. I mean 16 until 18 says, by this we know that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us love in word. Let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and in truth. Church, we have been loved so much. In the first song, it says we were stranger, but God loves us. Second song says, this is amazing grace, that he laid down his life for us. We have been loved so much. Let us build our life on God's love, right? Let us love each other. So let's sing a song for the one who is worthy of every song, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. And let us build our life in the love that God has displayed on us.
We could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and please.
in every town, in every tribe, Jesus is King. Let us go forth, heal and restore. Let us be known by our peace for the glory of the Father, for the glory of the Son, for the glory of the Spirit. Let us be known by our peace for the glory of the Father, for the glory of the Son, for the glory of the Spirit. Let us be known by our love. Let us be
by your love, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you would give us your love, the love that you laid for us, Lord. The joy, your joy and your peace, Lord. And God, we just want to pray as a community. May we unite and love each other just like you have loved us, Lord. And we pray as you are going to speak through Pastor Arnold, Lord. We pray that we all would unite one heart to listen to your word, Lord. And we pray that your spirit may work within us, Lord, in this room, in every person's house, Lord. And we pray that your name be glorified. For the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Okay, you may be seated.
Oh my, I was ready to sit down after hearing that sermon given by the singing. Wasn't that great? That was wonderful. Thank you so much, Gabby. That was great. That was great. Let's pray together. Father, many of us like to be known for something. Some of us like to be known, perhaps, for our achievements. Some of us like to be known for our intellect, our prowess, our athletic ability, so on and so forth. But Father, you've made it very clear in your word and through these songs that, Lord, let us be known by our love. Love can make a big difference. Father, if we would look at it the way you see it, it makes a big difference. So, Lord, open our eyes today that we may see glimpses of truth that you have for me. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Is there a difference between making a living and making a difference? You ever thought about that? Making a living or making a difference? Is there a difference between just doing something and doing something that changes the world around you for the better? I think there is. Yeah, of course. Let me give you an example of this. I read this story. It's a little dated, but that's okay. So there was, at one point in time in the United States, the mob, okay, the organized crime syndicates. And one of the leaders of the organized crime syndicate was a person named John Gotti. John Gotti. In fact, he was so famous, they made a movie of this guy, all right? And so what made him stand out among all the others was that his nickname was Teflon Don. He was the Teflon Don because no matter what the authorities tried to do, they could not convict this guy. Even though he was as guilty as all get out, they could not convict him. He always found a way to get out. Now, during his time, there was a prosecutor named Diana. She spent 7 years of her life to convict this guy. And finally, in 1986, she succeeded in convicting him of his crimes. She was having dinner with her brother and her mother and her parents, a family dinner, and this was before the conviction. And her brother said to her, well-meaning, however, a little hurtful, he said to her, "Why waste your time? There will always be a mob. You know, give up, sis. You're never going to win this case." Well, Diana got really upset at this point, and she stormed out of the room, and she was angry at her brother's pessimistic attitude. Later, she calls her mother and asks, "Is my brother right? Should I just give up and not go any further with this?" This is what her mother said. Listen to this, okay? Listen to this. Mothers, this is a great way to encourage your kids, okay? This is what the mother said. She said, "I go to the grocery store and I see other mothers who tell me about their children and grandchildren and how much money they make. Then," she said, "I tell them my daughter makes a difference." Okay, did you hear that? You may not have heard this statement before, but we believers are not put here on earth just to make a good living, but to make a difference. All right? You see the difference? Okay? You see the significance? And so I think that this little story tells us a lot. As a church, we are not here to just look spiritual, but to make a spiritual difference in the lives of people around us. That is why it is important to understand and apply what God teaches us in His Word about the Christian community, the church. God's church is what? To make a difference. God designed and intended it to do so. All right? We're not here just to collect buildings. We're not here just to amass great budgets. We're not here just to offer wonderful programs. Although all of those things are good. I'm not against those things. The Word of God is not against those things. It just says, at the end of the day, our purpose is to make a difference in the lives of people. Well, how are we going to do that? It's such a tall order. All right? Well, we have been going through this series of messages about the Christ-centered community, in other words, the church. And if you're just joining us now, the first message was on real worship. You know, people are just mesmerized by the choices of churches today. Big buildings, small buildings, fancy buildings, you know, very simple buildings, so on and so forth. People are mesmerized by the kind of music that goes on. You know, the fast music, the slow music, and all that. People are mesmerized by these charismatic preachers and not so charismatic preachers, okay? And so we're all into all these things, and yet the Bible tells us that what God really craves is real worship. And real worship is what? When a person has a real relationship with God, not a pretend one, but a real one. He's accepted Jesus Christ as his Savior, and he longs for that intimate relationship with his Heavenly Father. And when he worships from the heart. In spirit, meaning purity, and in truth, according to what God has revealed in His Word, all right? And then we talked about the next thing, not just real worship, but real fellowship. And real fellowship happens between God's people when people really share their lives with one another, okay? And so we discovered what that was. Now, this week, we're going to see the third thing. The third thing that God wants his church to be is real love in his church. Real love. Because why? Real love can make a difference in people's lives. All right? And so this is where we launch our sermon today. So the first question is, why is love for one another a characteristic of the Christian community? All right? You know, I go to different places and I talk to different people. I hear the same thing you see. I see the same thing that you see. And what we see is we see the word love, all right, splattered all over the place. And it's just dropped like as if, you know, it's something you're supposed to say. But love is really, really important. How important is it, Pastor? Well, let the Word of God speak for itself. It is foundational to all our relationships on earth, both to those inside and outside the community of Christ. Well, where do you see that? If you turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 13, verses 8 to 10, this is what you read. Owe nothing to anyone except to love one another. For he who loves his neighbor has fulfilled the law. For this, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet. And if there's any other commandment, it is summed up in this saying, you shall love your neighbors as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. Make no mistake, love is foundational to all of our relationships, okay? If you and I ever hope to live the abundant life, to live a life that makes a difference, we have to grasp the foundational belief of where love plays a major role. It adds meaning and significance to everything we do in this life on earth, okay? It's foundational, but it adds meaning and significance. If you turn in your Bibles again to 1 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, and we'll come back to this later, but in the first three verses, this is what we read. If I speak with tongues of men and of angels, but do not have love, I have become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and know mysteries of all and all knowledge, if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. Verse 3, and if I give all my possessions to feed the poor, and if I surrender my body to be burned, but do not have love, it profits me nothing. Okay? So all of these things that we might do or are able to do, if it lacks love, it's a zero. It doesn't amount to anything. If I have all of these great abilities but do not have love, my words are empty, my life is empty, and whatever I accomplish or achieve is empty. In other words, without love, life adds up to a great big zero. All right? This is not a heart. This is a zero. Okay? To a great big zero. So love adds meaning and significance to whatever I can do or will do. Also, thirdly, it is a birthmark of every believer. It is the birthmark of every believer. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. All right? You know, sometimes one of the quickest ways you can tell if a person really has a true, intimate relationship with God is to check their love meter. All right? If somehow it's showing red or zero, maybe they're not. Okay? We're not the ones to ultimately judge. Of course, only God knows who's saved and who isn't. However, love is a birthmark of believers. Okay? It's something that comes in our spiritual DNA. It becomes part of us as being the sons and daughters of sons of God. Fourthly, it is a command for every believer. John chapter 13, verse 34. a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. Okay? And so sometimes people say, well, I'm not going to do this because I don't see a command in the Bible that says I have to. All right? You can't do that with love because it's in there. He says, I give you a new commandment that you love one another. Okay? And so we're caught. Okay? We can't argue around that one. It's there. It's one of those that we must follow. Much of what ails the church today is a lack of obedience to the commands of God. And one of them is the command to love one another. That's why we see all kinds of conflict going on in the church. This is why we see people struggling greatly many, many times, because the love of God is not present, okay? Everyone does what is right in their own sight according to their own opinion. I'm sorry to say that what is happening to us, you know, all around the world right now, where everybody wants to do their own thing, so to speak, has also permeated the church. And so people come to church and they say, well, I like that, so I'll believe that. Or they'll say, I don't care for that one, so, you know, there's something wrong here, so I'm not going to follow that one. And so everybody's doing what is right in their own sight. And nothing much has changed, because even in the Old Testament, way back even in the book of Genesis, people did what was right in their own sight. Love for one another isn't present in the church as it should be, not because one can, but because one won't, okay? There is a big difference not having the ability and not having the will to love one another. And so oftentimes I have to really question myself about what I do with my time and with my actions and my attitude. I have to ask myself, is it what I should do? And if it is what I should do, why can't I do it? Is it because I can't? I don't have the ability? Or it's because I won't, because I don't have the will to do it. You see the difference? And so we ought to question ourselves when it comes to those things. So, love for one another is foundational. It is significant. It is a prominent virtue of every believer. It's a command from God that should be obeyed and practiced. So, hopefully, this answers the key question of why. Why should I love another person? Why should I? Because of all the things we just said. That answers the question. But there's another question. What does love for one another in a church look like? What's it supposed to look like? What happens between members of the family of God when they truly love one another? Okay? Now, I'll take you to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, which we read partially earlier. And you'll notice here, the Bible gives no less than 15 different descriptions of what loving one another looks like. 15. You know, this is pretty tough. You know, you say to yourself, wow, I didn't know love could express itself in so many ways. Well, yes, it can, according to the Word of God. And this isn't the only place, but this is one that we can cover, you know, in a meaningful way during the time we have together. And so turn with me in your Bibles again to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and starting with verse 4, okay? And so when we look at verse 4, we see several things. First of all, love is patient. It's slow to irritation or anger, okay? Slow to irritation and anger, all right? I don't know about you, but I came from a family where anger was not always under control, all right? And it seemed like because I'm family, I can be mad at you, you know, I can be angry at you, and here it comes, you know, this kind of thing. But it says when you love one another, it slows down. It is patient. And then it reads in verse 4, kind, rendering gracious, helpful service to others. It's free of pity, criticism, and slow to condemn, rendering gracious and helpful service to others. And then in verse 4, it says, not jealous. It doesn't burn with envy over what material things others have. It doesn't passionately guard what one has to the point of not wanting to share it with others. All right? You know, jealousy is tough. It's really tough. I'm not going to ask for a raise of hands, but how many of you have caught yourselves being jealous about something? You know, maybe you're jealous of a coworker who just got a promotion, or perhaps you're jealous about some classmate who has gotten a grade that you think you should have just gotten instead of them, and so on and so forth. But we are jealous, okay? And then verse 4 again says, not brag. It's just not this boasting, not vain or presumptuous words. It does not call undue attention to to oneself. It graciously accepts appreciation and reward for faithful deeds. It doesn't brag. It doesn't brag. And then in verse 4, it's not arrogant. It doesn't strut around with an inflated ego. It makes an accurate assessment of one's weaknesses and strength and refuses to belittle anyone who has not achieved or received as much as he or she has. It is not arrogant. Okay? So you see, just, you know, in a microcosm, you see in these verses some very stunning and stark descriptions of what it is to love one another. And as we proceed on through the list, you're going to probably become even a little more uncomfortable as you see what's happening. You see in verse 5, not act unbecomingly, not shameful or rude behavior. Rather, it seeks the right behavior at the right moment, okay? And then in verse 5, not seek its own. It does not demand its own rights, one's own rights to be honored and met. It does not demand to have its own way. Rather, it yields their rights and interests when others will be benefited. Okay? Verse 5, not provoked, not allow irritability or bitterness to creep into the relationship. It looks beyond a person's sins and reaches out to meet needs. All right? And this was not provoked. And then in verse 5, not take into account a wrong suffered. Now, this means this is an accounting term, and it means to credit or place in one's account. In other words, not record or store wrongs committed against themselves to you as you show love to one another. All right? I know that's hard. You know, I used to remark, I says, you know, each of us in this room, each of us in the world, we have an accounting degree. All right? And the accounting degree is we keep tabs of how all many wrongs people have done to us. All right? But somehow the pages that record the good things that people have done to us is pretty short. But we have volumes and volumes of books and records on the wrongs that people have done to us. We all have this accounting gene in each of us. But this is what it says. When we love one another, you what? You do not keep these accounts. Verse 6, not rejoice in unrighteousness, does not find pleasure nor sympathizes with the wickedness done by other people. Whoa, wow. When's the last time that you were unhappy with somebody who is engaged in unrighteousness? When was the last time? Well, hey, different strokes for different folks, you know. I don't want to jeopardize our relationship or anything. So when they tell an off-color joke, you know, I laugh with the best of them, you know, so on and so forth. No, you don't. You know, you don't rejoice in that kind of stuff. When a person brags and how the cashier at Walmart or something gave them more change than they deserve, and they're sitting out in the parking lot and just, praise God, God has blessed me today. Instead of like, well, no, I think maybe the right thing to do is go back and tell the cashier and give it back to them. I mean, after all, these cashiers, they're responsible for the accounts in the cashier, right? In the cash register. And I hate to see someone suffer because they made a small mistake. You know, things like this, okay? Do not rejoice in unrighteousness. Rejoice with the truth in verse 6. You should prefer to be hurt by a real friend with the truth than complimented by a foe with a lie. You see, sometimes people love to hear certain things, and especially certain things that may be a slight modification of the truth, okay? And so they say to themselves, you know, I'd rather hear a lie from somebody than to hear the truth. You know, but I've had to learn, I have to take the truth. I have to weigh it. I'd rather do that than have people say, oh, Pastor, you know, what you did was so kind of you and all this kind of stuff. Tell me the truth, okay? All right? I truly hope that whatever I do is get doing with truth and is out of a heart of love and heart of purity. But don't know until you tell me. Verse 7, bears all things. Bears means to cover so as to protect, like a shield, okay? Often used of a soldier who uses a shield. It withstands the blows and attacks of others, okay? Sometimes when things you love somebody so much, you have to defend them. You have to be there for them. You have to shield them from any greater hurt than is necessary, okay? And so that's what love does. It says it believes all things, okay? It means that this doesn't mean undiscerning or gullible. Rather, it means one is trusting as opposed to suspicious, cynical, and narrow, okay? It gives the benefit of a doubt. Gives the benefit of a doubt. You know, this is getting harder and harder, right? Because it really hits to the core of how each of us really think we love one another. The Bible says the Word of God is like a mirror. Guess what? Mirrors don't lie. Mirrors will tell you the truth. And so sometimes when we see the Word of God, we have to look at it and say, wow, it's telling the truth. It's telling the truth here. And then it hopes all things in verse 7. Does not give up anticipating and seeking the best in others. And it has an incurable confidence in God's ability to change people. I'm so thankful that in the course of my life, and I'm sure in the course of your life and your life and your life, there's people who believed in you, even when you didn't believe in yourself, right? But there are people who truly loved you enough to believe in you, and you are the person you are today because someone believed in you. They loved you, okay? And that's what happens here. Hopes all things, does not give up anticipating, seeking the best in others. And we just covered that. And endures all things. Determination and courage to press on, even when facing humanly insurmountable obstacle. It refuses to quit or to retreat. It is patient and tough in the storms of life. So this is just one snapshot. This is one portion. 15 different descriptions of what it is to love another person in the body of Christ and outside the body of Christ, okay? And so if you're sitting out there and you're saying to yourself, do you love one another in the body of Christ or maybe outside the body of Christ? And you would say, oh, sure I do. Okay, look at this list. Does this apply to you? Okay. In what degree? How much? Does this really reflect how I love my family, members of my family? Does this truly reflect how I love the people I work with the people I learn with? Does this really reflect the people in my church and how I feel towards them and how I respond to them? All right. I mean, all of us can learn something by looking into the mirror of Scripture and see what it says about loving one another, okay? When love is present between people, the invisible becomes visible. Did you hear that? The invisible becomes visible. You know, when people say, you know, to myself, yeah, you worship a loving God. Show me. Whoa, wasn't that convicting? Can you say, well, I'm here, aren't I? How have I treated you? I'm just a representative. I'm just a small segment of what our loving God feels, how he feels towards you. Whoa, that's a heavy responsibility. That's a heavy responsibility. Nevertheless, that's what God calls for. God has high and definite expectations of what it means to love one another. Expectations that will make a real difference in being and living for everyone who comes in contact with it. People will be changed when they come in contact with the real love of God. I know I was. I was, frankly, blown away when, as a young person, I went to church for the very first time. And for the very first time in my life, I felt accepted, okay? I felt that people really were patient with me and people were willing to take me in as I am and say, let's go from here together. Boy, that was like a breath of fresh air. That was like getting a shot of fresh oxygen, if you will. You know, you just, whoom, you know, you just suddenly get energized. And that's what happened. Well, this brings us to the last question. How is love for one another going to happen? Okay? How does loving one another become a reality in our life? Let me suggest a few things to you. First of all, may I suggest, and I know that this may be maybe a little hard for some of us, but, you know, to be a loving person, you yourself have to be lovable. You ever thought about that? Okay? To love other people, you have to be lovable. All right? You have to be willing to bear all things. You have to be willing to be patient. You have to be willing. All of these things we just talked about. When you're getting called on, when someone says, yeah, that wasn't really nice what you just said, you have to be willing to take it. And then when you are lovable, then you and I, in turn, can be loving other people. Because people will see it. People will see it. And I know sometimes, you know, our families, our background, our life experience, and all this kind of stuff, you know, we find it hard to be lovable. I know that. I've been there, done that. Still there sometimes, okay? But to be loving to people, you have to be lovable yourself. And then another thing is that takes an act of the will, an act of the will. In John chapter 14, it says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. Love God and keep his commandments, okay? Keep that in your head. Life isn't about me, all right? It's about God. It's about obeying God. If this life that I so desperately want, the kind of life that is abundant and free, like Jesus has promised, then it has to be with love, and it comes out of obedience to God. An unconditional love, not just loving those who agree with us or look like us, but everyone, okay? So first thing is be lovable. Second thing, commit your will to being obedient to God. And then the third thing is be dependent on God. Active dependence upon God. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. And hope does not disappoint because the love of God has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. All right? When you and I determine once and for all that we will love one another in the body of Christ and outside the body of Christ, we have to depend upon God to pour out his love through us. We can't control everything. You know, when I look at my children and I say to them, you know, sometimes they exasperate me. Sometimes they do all kinds of crazy things, you know, and all that kind of stuff. And I just say, I have to love them. I have to keep loving them. Oh, God, help me love them. Oh, my, help me love them. You know, that's what I got to do. That's what I got to do. So you can do those three things. So where do we start? Where do we start? I really think the key to this is what happens in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Commit yourself to follow the Lord. Commit yourself to follow the Lord. You know, sometimes I'm more committed than other days. How about you? Right? Some days it's easy to be committed to God, and other days not so good to be committed to God. But this is key to everything. Commit yourself to follow the Lord. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. Wow. Wow. No other way, guys. No other ways. And then, commit yourself to be under the control of the Holy Spirit. Ephesians tells us to be filled with the Spirit. That means to be controlled by the Spirit of God. Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 to 25 tells us what happens when the Holy Spirit is in control. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is what? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with his passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit of God. All right? So I'm not asking you to, you know, to obey some man-made list, but to follow the Spirit of the living God and let him control your life. Commit to love unconditionally those who love us and agree, not only those who love us and agree with, but all those who don't and won't. All right? To do that. The Christ-centered community should be characterized by real love for one another. By its very nature, the love of one another is that the Christian community practices and it's above and beyond all earthly expectations. By God's design, when we travel with others, loving one another, our journey on earth goes more swiftly, smoothly, and purposefully and happily. You know, I saw a commercial this week that just really struck me. I'm a kind of a commercial junkie, okay? Because I think it's a real great skill that people who write commercials, they have so little time to say anything. And so every word counts, okay? And so I saw this commercial, and it says, don't see the world as it is, but see the world as what it can be. And that will make the difference. Don't see the church as it is, but see the church as what it should be in the eyes of God. Real worship, real fellowship, real love. And when we all work together towards that singular goal to be the church that God wants us to be, not only will each of our lives be more enriched, but also the world will stand up and say, whoa. Whoa, wow, that is something that is missing in my life, and that's what I need to have. You see? So all of this is really important. Now, we're not going to stop here. We're going to go on to some other things that God expects of his church, and I hope that you will be with us through those times, and I hope it make a difference not only in this church, LSFC, but also in our own individual lives and families and homes, okay? Let's be committed to that. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, continually you challenge us. You challenge us to see not only who we are, and then you help us see what we could be, and what we can be, and what we should be. And then, Father, you tell us that when these things happen, what the results will be. Something so astronomical, something so awesome that we have never even contemplated it, because we are not able to bear it. But Father, you desire a church that is real. A church where its people are involved in real worship, real fellowship, and real love. And I pray, Father, that with the help of your Holy Spirit, with the power of the Holy Spirit in us, that we will be able to attain a large measure of that. Thank you, Father, for each one that is here today and those who may be here over the internet and so on and so forth. Father, may this message really make a difference in their life and in the life of their church, wherever it may be. Thank you, dear Father, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, and I really, really pray that God will make this message and the other messages come together for you, and you're able to connect the dots, and you're able to see what God wants from each of us. God bless you, and we'll see you again, Lord willing, next week.